The opinions expressed on the Simone Edwards Show by our guests are solely the opinions of the original source who expressed them. They do not necessarily represent the opinions of the station, its owners, and or the Simone Edwards Show and those affiliated with it. In no event will the Simone Edwards Show, this station, its owners, guests, hosts, or affiliates be liable for the information disseminated on the program, including, without limitation, any loss or damage, indirect or otherwise, arising from information presented on the show. We trust you are of legal age and will consult appropriate professionals prior to employing any opinion expressed on the show. Many of the topics discussed are personal in nature, and some people may disagree with the opinions expressed on the show. We are open to your constructive criticism and or ideas for future radio programs. Please feel free to email us at thesimoneedwardsshow@gmail.com. Again, that's thesimoneedwardsshow@gmail.com. Hey everyone, we want to welcome you to another installment of the Simone Edwards Show here on this station. We are at a new time on the KTAV station. We are beginning at 11 a.m. this month, continuing on into perpetuity if the Lord says the same. So we want to welcome you. Thank you so much for joining us as we are tuning in, as you are tuning in for our interview. We have here in studio a lovely lady that I met recently at a local networking event here in San Diego, and she has an amazing startup that she has been working on. She's been doing it actually for kind of quite some time, but she's now officially going forth and we going forward in the vision. And so we wanted to introduce you to her because at the end of the day, that's what the Simone Edwards Show is really all about. We want to give people who are doing great things in the community an opportunity to share with you their platform, what they're doing, where they're going, and how you can help. So without further ado, I want to introduce to some and present to others Miss Tiwana Carlton of Girls Helping Girls One Hand at a Time. Welcome to the show and say hello to our audience.
Hello, audience. And thank you again for asking me to come and be a part of your show, to Simone. Thank you
Absolutely. My pleasure. And so she's a little bit nervous, y'all.
Yes,
and so
yes.
We're going to relax. We're just going to relax into it. You know how we do here. So let's get to know you a little bit before we jump off into the deep end.
Okay.
Okay. So do you have a hero?
Yes, I do. I have a hero. My grandparents are my heroes.
Really?
Yes.
Why? Tell me. I'm so fascinated.
Yes, my grandparents just set the example of family, of working hard. My grandfather was a sharecropper, and so he did not get, you know, as far as the education. I think he may have went to maybe elementary or junior high school. I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. But he showed me the example of hard work and what hard work does and how it pays off. And my grandmother was at home, and so she raised me in order for my mother to complete her college education.
Right.
And so they just showed me examples of being strong, showing me the examples of, you know, working hard. And if you work hard, this is what you can achieve in life, and you let nothing and no one say that you can and cannot do anything. If you set your mind to it, you set your goals to it, that you can achieve it.
I absolutely love that. With it being Black History Month, I want to segue a little bit because of your grandparents.
Okay.
What did you learn from them about what life was like for them growing up that you still carry with you today?
They taught me how to treat people.
Okay.
How you, if you treat, you know, how to treat people, how to be positive and not have a negative, the negative thoughts, and because somebody may say something negative to you or treat you in a negative way, you Michelle Obama said, we take the high road.
Right.
And she showed me how to do that just by not saying, but giving me the example of doing it. Because, you know, in those times, you know, it was, you know, slavery, and
right.
you couldn't walk on a certain side of the street, and you couldn't go in different stores and that type thing. And so she just showed me no matter what life throws at you,
right.
you can be better. And you don't allow that negativity or the things that have happened in our past. We're going to break that generation curse. We're not going to allow you to take some of those negative things into the next generation.
Oh, I love it. So now, was this here in San Diego?
No, I'm originally from Alabama.
Oh, my God. Oh, this is just getting better. Okay, wait a minute. Wait a minute. I need to calm down. Okay. So that adds so much more. Not that, you know, racial tension on the West Coast isn't the same.
Right.
But it isn't the same.
Right, right, right.
Right?
Right.
So growing up in Alabama, kind of what we call the Deep South.
Right. Yes.
And having to, for Black Americans to live in fear of their lives.
Right.
You know, and even more so, I would think, than even the Midwest,
right,
where you definitely couldn't go into certain places.
Right.
And you had to walk on the other side of the street.
Yes.
And for them to instill all of that in you, what did you see? What did you experience? What do you remember experiencing and seeing in their day-to-day lives?
Now, the only thing that I can really speak about is seeing as far as being treated differently.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see it because my parents didn't teach me about color.
That's awesome.
So they taught me to treat everybody the same.
Right.
Now, after I moved to California, first time, that's when I experienced racism.
Interesting.
I never experienced it. My friends, some of my friends are white. We go to this high school we go to is white and Black. Mm. So we didn't, when we would have activities in school, we didn't separate ourselves. We all sat together.
Right.
I never had anyone call me the N-word. I never had anyone to disrespect me. I was able to go to my friends' homes. And these kids that I went to school with, their parents were millionaires.
Mm-hmm.
I could go to their front door. I didn't have to go to the back door. They would just say, come in. You know, they would know me by name. And when I would knock, and they, oh, come on in.
Mm-hmm.
Come on in. You know, but so I never experienced racism.
In
the South.
Until you got to the
West. Until I got to California.
So what was that like?
That was different because I didn't realize it until I had walked out the store that I had experienced, you know, being followed in a store. I didn't, like, are you serious? Are you walking behind me?
Wow.
Are you watching me pick up stuff? Or every time I would go down an aisle, that person would be at the other end of the aisle.
Wow.
They didn't have a basket. They was just walking. And I'm saying, so are you really watching me?
Right.
Do you think I'm about to steal something? And so, to me, I walked out the store without buying anything because I'm saying to myself, did he just follow me thinking that I was about to steal because of the color of my skin?
Right.
And so that was just, it was very traumatic because I couldn't understand that.
Right.
Because by being raised in the South from preschool,
mm-hmm,
until I graduated high school, never experienced it. My friends, my grandparents made sure that the door was always open for my friends. And it wasn't that, no, your white friends can't come. No, it was never that.
Right.
Tell your friends to come. They can stay overnight. Or we want to have a get-together, you know, with my friends. Fine. But, you know, they knew not to disrespect my parents because my parents, you know, set that rule. You would not disrespect us in our home. So I never experienced it, like I said, until I moved to California. And to go back home and to be able to share that with my classmates, because my high school classmates were still very close.
Right.
And we just sit around and talk. We don't color. We don't know color.
Right.
We come together no matter what the situation is when we go back home, or if some parent or some relative in the family dies, we always come together. And when this past August I was able to go home, and we got together, my friends, my classmates, we all got together, and they were so happy because I hadn't been home in 10 years, and we just got together and we ate and fellowship together. But it's never been about color.
Right.
And so I've talked to my counselors from high school, because we still keep in contact.
Right.
And she you know, mentioned to me, she was like, you won't believe how things have changed. And I'm like, well, how have they changed? She said, now in the gym, the white kids sit on one side and the Black kids sit on another side.
Stop.
And now I graduated in 85.
Wow.
So here it is, 2017, and you're segregating yourself when our forefathers then had to fight. For us
integration.
Right.
Right.
And see, like, where I'm from, my parents, my grandmother, mother, and uncles both went to the same high school.
Mm-hmm.
So integration in our community didn't come until, I think, the 70s.
Wow.
And so the first Black family was my neighbors when, you know, after I grew up and they, you know, were grown, mm-hmm. I found that they were the first family to integrate the high school.
Wow.
Because we had our own school. And so to go back home now, mm-hmm. and that school is empty, and to know that so much history is there, and to know that people still today are having to, you know, deal with segregation.
Right.
You know, I taught my son, you don't see color. You treat everybody the same.
Right.
Yes.
That is so amazing.
Yes.
And
yes.
It all stems from your grandparents.
Right.
From what they had to endure,
yes.
and then what they instilled in you as a result of what they went
right.
through.
And you know they went through a lot.
Right.
Because my grandmother would tell me stories about how she could just go to the meat market. And you know, at the meat market, they have the scales.
Mm-hmm.
And so when the man would put the meat on the scale, he would put his fingers on the scale. So therefore, the meat costs more. She was 17 years old. And she told him, now, when you take your fingers off, I need to know that price. So she was being defiant.
Wow.
Speaking up and saying, no, I'm not paying for your fingers. My mother sent me to pay for the meat.
Right.
And so when she said that to him as a white man,
mm-hmm.
he was like, you get your meat and don't you come back in this store. She said, I'll be back to this store. And that's what she did. She went back. But she stood up because she was saying, no, I'm not paying for your fingers. My family can't eat your fingers. We can just eat the food, the meat. And so she meant that. And
right.
she was 17 years old.
Right.
And at the time, during those times,
it could have cost her life.
Yes, she could have been lynched.
Right.
Yes. Her parents' house could have been burned.
Right.
But because she stood up and she had parents that stood up and her father went back to the store and he told her, she told you right. Take your fingers off the scale. We're not paying for fingers. We only want the meat that we need that's on the scale.
Wow.
So they endured a lot. But, you know, she just making sure that we instilled that not only myself, but my mother and my two uncles knew that too, that you stand up for what's right.
Oh, I love it. Your history, your family history is so rich.
Yes.
Like, I could just sit and listen to you. But that's not why we're here, and I'm not going to be selfish. I'm not going to be selfish today, you guys. I'm not. Oh my gosh, that is so amazing, and to know how that has shaped you.
Right.
And we're actually, because it's funny, as I was going through your Facebook page, and I saw the three little girls.
Yes.
And we'll talk about that later.
Uh-huh.
The three little girls that started
right.
Girls Helping Girls.
Right.
And how your what you learned in your formative years.
Right.
With your grandparents,
right.
How that has kind of led you down this path,
right.
To now you're working with young girls.
Yes.
Okay, so
yes.
We have one more question before
okay.
we go to break. I'm going to pick a fun one.
Okay.
since we're in the vein of family,
okay.
Do you have a favorite family tradition? And
yes.
If so, what is it?
Yes, our favorite family tradition mm-hmm. is to try to prepare meals together.
Oh, I love that.
And if one comes home before the other,
mm-hmm.
Go ahead and start, and mm-hmm. I'll come in and I'll, you know, bring up the back end.
Right.
And we try to make sure that we eat together, and we also try to make sure we pray together at our meals. And so that just is about family. It's about, and not only our family, but we share it with complete strangers. We open our doors.
Right.
You know, people say, since moving to Cali, you don't lock your door.
Right.
Well, we just, from being from the South, people mm-hmm. know, you know, when you open the door, come on in. So, you know, we're so used to that. But now I have to remember I'm in California
yes.
and I have to lock my door
yes.
because who knows me, who may walk in.
Yes.
So that's, you know, our family dishes. So we try to make it, we not only just for our family,
right.
but people that we meet.
Right.
And we feel that bond and that connection, you know, that spiritual connection, that bond. And we invite them into our home. You know, come by, have dinner. If not, you know, if you're at somewhere and you're working, I'll bring you a plate.
Okay.
Yeah, so we do that.
Tony, I think we just found a new family. Simone Edwards Show.
Anytime.
I absolutely love that. I think that's a wonderful family tradition. And so you don't wait until like special holidays. This is just an everyday
yes,
practice.
Every day. We do it every day. I have a girlfriend. She's from Jamaica.
Mm-hmm.
And she
Woo-hoo.
Comes by after work and she teases me all the time. She said, I have to stop coming by. And I'm like, why? Did we do something to offend you? She said, no, I've gained 27 pounds. And I can't keep coming by his because we cook mm-hmm. breakfast, lunch,
wow.
and dinner.
Oh, my goodness.
Now, some days we may skip lunch, mm-hmm. you know, if we busy, you know, having doing things in life. So we may skip lunch and not mm-hmm. cook. But when you come, we definitely going to have breakfast and we definitely going to have dinner. Mm-hmm. And so when she gets off, she's always saying, I have to go on a diet. Can we have salad today? We're like, no, we have to have a full course meal. That's the thing about being from the South. Mm-hmm. We love to eat.
Okay.
We may not eat always healthy, but we love to eat.
But one of the things that I'm hearing, though, that is, and especially with it being Black History Month, mm-hmm. That the hallmark of family, mm-hmm. really of any family,
right.
is the sense of coming together, mm-hmm. of creating a community, and like you said, having prayer,
right.
having God at the center of it.
Right.
Because it's those things that strengthen a family unit,
right.
and that gives you a sense of connectedness
right.
and purpose.
Right.
So I think that's really amazing. And
yeah.
the fact that you open your door to other people mm-hmm. only teaches the generations around you to do the same thing.
Right. One of being able to pass it on.
Right.
You know, because that's where it starts. Because you can sit down at the table, you can share about your day, mm-hmm. share your ups and your downs, and then we can, you know, talk about it, and maybe we'll have a solution. Maybe we can come together and get a solution. Mm-hmm. And if we have ideas or things we want to do or what we want to do in our community or in our lives to improve, you know, our life better.
Right.
So that's what we do. We do it at the table. You know, we laugh, we cry, we do it all. It's right there at the dinner table.
Absolutely
yes.
love it. All right, you guys, we're going to take a break for station identification. We will be back with Miss Tiwana Carlton of Girls Helping Girls, One Hat at a Time, an amazing startup nonprofit here in the county of San Diego. We'll see you soon.
You are listening to the San Diego Station of Inspiration. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, KTAV Radio. For more information on how you can advertise your business, event, or services, please visit us online at ktav.tv or call 619-246-6131.
We are back here in studio with Miss Tiwana Carlton of Girls Helping Girls, One Hand at a Time, a really incredible startup, not-for-profit organization that's here in the city of San Diego. So I read through your bio, and you have been working with children for over 15 years now.
Yes.
Has it always been with girls, or did you work with both genders?
I work with both genders.
Okay.
I started off working with young girls and young boys because I had a daycare in
okay.
my home.
Okay.
So I had kids ages, you know, 1 month up to 12 years old.
Oh, wow.
So I've had a variety of kids. And, you know, by having a daycare, mm-hmm. they were able to get that one-on-one attention. I mm-hmm. never had a large daycare, you know, where you have 15, 20 kids. So it was always a small group, no more. About 4 or 5 kids at a time.
Okay.
Now, in the summer, you would have more
right.
because you would have, you know, the parents that didn't have places for the kids to go and then, you know, and couldn't afford the larger daycares, mm-hmm. you know, in the city. And so by having at-home daycare, I was able to give those kids one-on-one. And, you know, we just had a lot of activities. It was fun. We were able to spend time outside in the summer. So by the time the parents would pick them up, you know, either it was time for ready for supper, take a bath, tell me how your day went, and they were able to, you know, to go into relax and enjoy their rest of their day.
Oh, that's lovely. So now, Girls Helping Girls, mm-hmm. how long has the organization been in existence?
I started in May of 2014
okay.
here in San Diego
okay.
with the help of the San Diego Law School. They have an entrepreneurship clinic
oh, okay.
on campus.
Okay.
And I searched out and found that they could assist me. And they have a program that they do from startup. They do everything from doing your bylaws, whatever you need, from getting my name to doing all that. So that's when I started. But due to me having ankle surgery and being on the weight bearing, I'm just now getting out in the community, letting people know that I'm here. So we started about May of 2014. So
in 2014, and then you kind of had some hurdles along the way that
right.
you had to overcome.
Right.
You know, the natural progression of life.
Yes, yes.
And so now you're back to kind of getting the word out about the fact that you're there and you have the service that you can provide to parents.
Right.
So San Diego Law School mm-hmm. provides, is it a free course or is it a paid course?
Now they have, what they have is a sliding fee scale.
Okay.
So it depends on your income.
Uh-huh.
And then they'll tell you exactly what you have to pay and if it's a service that they can help you with.
Okay.
And so I went in and they told me, yes, I could help you. This is what we charge. Mm-hmm. This is you go and you tell them your fee. You give them the fee. What is it you want to start? What type of corporation? Is it a corporation? Is it a nonprofit? That type thing. And you go in and you present it to them.
Okay.
So you just write up a proposal, and that's what I did. I wrote about what I wanted to do, exactly what I wanted. And so then we went in and decided, okay, you'll be doing a nonprofit. And so what they did was they wrote my bylaws,
mm-hmm.
by what I said and what I desired.
Mm-hmm.
They helped me make sure I secured my name with the Secretary of State, making sure that we are in the process right now of getting my 501(c). So they do all that. They help you step by step. So it's no, not having to go out and pay a lawyer, because I couldn't afford to pay a lawyer $20,000-$30,000,
right,
to do it. And that's why I was so happy that I found them, because, like I say, it's on a sliding fee scale. And they'll be able to, do it all, where you would have to go to an attorney and pay $20,000-$30,000.
Right.
And he's just going to tell you, okay, this is the step, this is what you have to do, where they help you step by step. When they write it, you look at your bylaws. If it's not what you want, okay, they come back in, you correct it, and you do it like that. So, yeah, it's out there. The service is out there at the San Diego Law School. They have an entrepreneurship clinic.
Excellent. So you heard it here first. Future and budding entrepreneurs, if you're looking for a way to get your business started, you just found out from Ms. Tiwana what you can do. The San Diego Law School, contact them, and they do have a sliding fee scale, mm-hmm. for their entrepreneur clinic.
Right.
So make sure that you ask for the entrepreneur clinic.
Correct.
Okay.
That's right.
Excellent. So they got you started. So now you got set up.
Mm-hmm.
What is your target demographic? What is your target audience for Girls Helping Girls?
My target audience is girls ages 10 mm-hmm. to 17 years of age.
Okay.
I thought, at the age of 10, you're about to go, you're in fourth grade, about to go into fifth grade,
right,
soon to be junior high. So now you're going into the teenage years.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that this would be the age that we should be able to get those young girls, because now they're starting to set goals. They're deciding what they want to do and be in life.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought at the age of 10, that would be a great age to start getting these girls in. And hopefully that I'll be able to get girls at that age, so by the time they're 17, they can come back into the program and help those girls coming in at that age, at the age of 10,
mm-hmm.
so that they can see what it is to be a part of the program and what they've learned, and now that they can pass it on to the younger generation of the 10-year-olds coming in.
Oh, I love that. Mm-hmm. I absolutely love it. What need are you trying to fill with that demographic, and what need are you trying to fill for the community?
I'm trying to be able to offer these young girls a mentoring program.
Okay.
Somewhere they feel safe, somewhere they can interact with other young girls their ages,
mm-hmm.
Find out, talk to them, so that they'll know what their dreams and their goals are, and to be able to find out how we can come together, mm-hmm. as a group and achieve those goals, and just show them, want to be able to show them that it's so much out there that they could be doing, and not allow someone to put them in a box,
right,
and say, this is what you can do and this is what you will only do.
Right.
So I wanted them to be able to open their minds. One thing I've tried to teach my son is we may not have the money to travel, but we can go to the library, mm-hmm. get a book, and whatever city or state you want to, if you want to go to another country, let's get that book and let's read about it. And then, as the time go on, okay, I set a goal because I want to go here.
Right.
So now I'm going to see how I've read the book.
Mm-hmm.
I know what it's about.
I love it.
And so now that I read the book, now I'm financially able,
right,
to go to that place.
Right.
So I want them not to believe that concept, like, you can't go here, you can't do that because you don't have the resources, your family doesn't have the money, it's the community you live in, it's the household, you may come from a household where, it's abused or, that type of thing. But I want these young girls to know that no matter what is going on in your household, or what may happen in your life, don't allow that to stifle you from going and pursuing your dreams and your goals.
I absolutely love it. And it's so fitting with the current political climate that we're in.
Right.
It's so fitting with the recent change that's taken place in our government and kind of the shift that has taken place. And, you know, don't really have a dog in the fight, but when you consider the fact that, you know, we have someone who's in office who has kind of run on a platform of being dismissive towards women.
Right.
I think that that's so important now more than ever for our young girls to be corralled together to remind them that you have value and you have worth outside of someone dictating to you that these are your limitations and kind of, you know, really all you're good for is birth and children and cooking meals.
Right. Cooking, you know, cleaning.
Cooking and cleaning.
Right.
That, you know, that's all you're good for. We definitely do not want to send that message to our young girls. Now, if that's what someone wants to be and that's what they want to do, that's completely different.
That's different.
And we support you 100%.
Right.
But if a woman wants to be an engineer or an astronaut or a physicist or the next president, you know, we can't tell, we should not communicate to her, or should it be communicated to her that that's a too lofty of a goal for you to attain to.
Right, and not allow her to stay in that box.
Right.
And not to hit that glass ceiling and break it, because we have to teach them, you know, show them, we have to guide them, we have to show them what resources are available.
Right.
And we have to encourage our children. We have to have an open communication.
Right.
I tell my family, my parents didn't just come out and say some things. They did it by showing me.
Right.
You know, and sometimes we have to do that. We have to have that communication. I have a son, and like I said, I made sure that we could talk about anything.
Right.
And I still tell him today, he's 26 years old, and I tell him all the time, don't allow anyone to put you in a box.
Right.
If it's something you want to achieve, no matter what it is, how much it costs, what extent you have to go, if that's what you desire, then you do that. And I'm here to support you, whatever I can do. Because a lot of times you have people, and you have teachers, you have people in your community. Sometimes you have people in your home that will tell you, no, you can't do that.
Right.
That's not going to be done. I don't know who told you you could do that. Right. Don't allow somebody else's negativity and the things that they have been through take you down and you be in that box and say, well, I'm just going to stay here because somebody else said, I can't do it and it's not right for me to do it. Don't allow that. You have to have a voice.
Right.
And you got to use that voice. I'm not saying be disrespectful, but you have to use that voice to speak out. Because if you don't, you'll get to the age of 40 and 50 years old and saying, woulda, shoulda, coulda.
Right.
Time has passed you by.
Right.
So now what am I going to do? I'm going to still stay in this box? No, I'm not.
Right.
And that's one of the things that I did for myself. I didn't allow what somebody else said I shouldn't and shouldn't do. Mm. I'm 50 years old. Mm-hmm. And I've decided I'm going back to get my education. I'm going back to get my degree. Because I'm not going to allow somebody to say, because you're 50 years old, well, time has changed. The subjects have changed. Okay. I still have credits, and those credits I'm going to bring with me if the school says that, you know, they're used. But I'm not going to allow somebody to tell me, because I'm 50 years old, that I can't sit in that seat and learn and further my education. I'm not going to allow that. So I don't want these girls to allow someone to say, well, you're going to stay in that box because that's where you need to be, and you're not going to learn. You dumb. No, I can learn. I'm going to learn.
I absolutely love it. And one of the things that I'm getting from you as we're talking is, you know, it's one thing when someone stands from a theoretical standpoint and, you know, they speak about a subject matter and I've done this research and I found this out and based on this, this is what I believe.
Right.
And it's another thing when somebody is not only espousing it, but they're living it.
Right.
Because now those girls that are in your organization
can see it.
They get to look up to you and they say, you know, can you imagine the impact of being 10 years old or 13 or 16, even 17, you know, which is the culmination of your program.
Right.
To be 17 years old and to be like, the woman who is over this organization is 50 years old and she's going back to college.
That's right.
and she's not letting anyone stop her. Mm-hmm. So if she can go to college at 50, mm-hmm. then why can't I do it?
Right.
Or why can't, you know, I be a chef or whatever, right. whatever aspirations,
which is expired to
why
be.
Can't I do that? Because the person who's over me right. is living what they're preaching.
Right.
Oh, I absolutely
yes.
love that.
Yes.
I love it.
Yes.
We have 1 minute left and I think I'm just going to go to break because I don't, I either gain or lose points.
Okay.
And right now I'm winning.
Okay.
You see her laughing.
Yes, yes.
I'm winning. And so I want to keep my winning streak going. Okay. So we'll be back in just a moment. We are back here with Ms. Carlton of Girls Helping Girls. One of the things we were talking about offline is your determination. And I love the determination that you have on the inside and that you're going to instill in these girls.
Right.
Because life is going to happen.
Right.
You know what I mean? To think that we're going to live in this bubble where nothing is ever going to happen, and especially with you being a woman of faith.
Right.
You know, to live in this la la land
right.
to think that, oh, because I have faith in God, nothing bad is ever gonna happen. No. Life is going to happen.
Exactly.
But it's what you have within you
right.
that's gonna determine your response when you get knocked down.
Right.
Or when you get detoured or when
right.
you get derailed
right.
or things seem to be going life is throwing you off kilter.
Yes.
And so your determination mm-hmm. is, I think, such an amazing beacon of hope in this time mm-hmm. that we're living in, that it's no matter the obstacles,
right.
no matter the odds, I will make it
right.
to the other side.
Right.
Absolutely love that.
Yes, because I've had some knockdowns.
Right.
I've had some doubts.
Right.
I've had close friends say, you know, I don't think you should do that.
Right.
I don't think that's the road you should travel on as doing a nonprofit and working with young girls. I don't think that's what you want to do. But I'm saying in the back of my head, now you didn't give me this vision.
I love it.
God gave this to me.
Right.
And so am I going to allow what you say mm-hmm. to deter me from what God has said? This is what I need you to do. It wasn't like I wrote it down on a piece of paper and I said, this is what I'm going to do. No, God said as a whisper to me, I need you to start a nonprofit and mm-hmm. I need you to be working with young girls. And so you can't allow that noise. Mm-hmm. Because you're going to have a lot of noise. You're going
right.
to have a lot of knockdowns. You're going to have people doubting you. You're going to have people in your camp mm-hmm. that's with you, but really not with you.
Right.
They're standing in the background waiting for you to knock down, waiting mm-hmm. for you to fail and saying, see, I told you not to do that. Mm-hmm. So you have to know how, that was the reason, you know, wanted to have this mentor group, that you can stand firm mm-hmm. in your beliefs. No matter what God you serve mm-hmm. or what religion you are in, it's not about religion. It's about what you believe in your God mm-hmm. and what you have went to him about and being able to know that I can stand here, do what he has given you, the task, whatever it may be, mm-hmm. and that I'm not going to allow that outside noise, those knockdowns, those roadblocks mm-hmm. to say, oh, no, I'm not going to do it. I just give up. I throw my hands up. And right when you're about to give up, is right when the breakthrough is about to happen. Mm-hmm. And so you can't allow that. Because you're going to have people, billionaires and millionaires and people that sitting around the table and you know, you present your proposal and this is what I want to do and this is how, and they're going to be no. So am I going to allow that no to stop me? Mm-hmm. Am I going to allow those detours to just knock me off track? No. Now I'm going back, and I'm going to work just that much harder, and I'm going to prove to you that I can do it.
Or maybe that just wasn't that door for you.
Exactly.
You don't give up on the dream. You
right.
just change
right.
the goal.
Right.
Okay. So there is a picture on your Facebook page that dates back to 2010, and it's you with three little girls
yes.
during the holidays. And the caption reads, "This is how Girls Helping Girls started." Take us on that journey
okay.
with those three little girls to from there, from 2010
yes.
to 14
yes.
when this started.
Those girls that you saw on the Facebook page, I lived in Port Hueneme, California.
Okay.
And I just moved into the community.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed these girls were just hanging out. These young girls were in third grade,
mm-hmm.
third, fourth, and fifth grade.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed that they were just hanging out. They were wearing those short shorts. They were out with little boys that were much older than them.
Oh, my goodness.
So I'm thinking to myself, okay, where's the parents?
Mm-hmm.
Why are you hanging out? It's school time, and do you not have homework?
Mm-hmm.
So I said to myself, I have to do something because I see the road that they're heading down.
Right.
And as a parent and as a person in the community, am I going to allow them not to be able to live a full life? Am I not going to be able to, and meaning full life is meaning to have their dreams and to be able to pursue their goals and to, yes, you're going to fall. Yes, you'll be knocked down. But how is it that I can somehow stop some of those pitfalls?
Mm-hmm.
And so what I did is I went home and I wrote out invitations on just a construction paper.
Mm-hmm.
And I invited those young girls and their parents in my home. And I told them I wanted to start a community club. And in that community club, I told them, you know, we'll do field trips. We'll go to the schools and, you know, see what type of activities they have, go to the library, just expose those young girls. And what I did was I tried to find out, you know, what they have, you know, what they've been through as a family, some of their goals, what they wanted to do in life. And what I found out, these young girls had never rode a public school bus, a city bus.
Mm.
They didn't have a library card. Basic things, you mm-hmm. know, a library card. I think everybody probably got a library card, probably elementary school.
Right.
You know, when you start school, you get a library card. They didn't have library cards.
Wow.
Something as simple as going to Subway. They had not even eaten at Subway.
Okay.
So that's why I decided, you know, okay, it's something I have to do. And so what I did was we started meeting once a month. I'd have mm-hmm. different activities. We did school bullying.
Mm-hmm.
We had a training on that. They got certificates for participating. We also did, I'm trying to think, what was the other thing? Oh, we did the California beach cleanup. We participated mm-hmm. in that. And so just exposing these young girls to something else that was positive.
Right.
That something may be going on at home that they really didn't want to talk about. And being able to say, you know, it's more to life than hanging on this corner,
mm-hmm.
being out here with these little boys,
mm-hmm.
and going down a road that you are at the age that you should not be going down.
Right.
And should not be experiencing some of these things. And so that's how Girls Help Girls got started on that end. And so once I moved to San Diego, I still was praying to God because I didn't know anybody. And I'm still praying to God like, okay, God, I know I'm not just here to be a mother, a wife, a sister, an aunt. I got to do something.
Right.
And so that's how the vision of Girls Help Girls came along. But that's how it started. But I didn't know at that time in 2010 that was my purpose in life. Had no clue. I was just wanting to do something with the girls. We started a community library in my community. So what I would do is I would go and buy the books. And they'd have the books in my home. So if anybody wanted to come by. And I had an open door policy. You can come. You can read the books. We take care of them. If you want to check them out, you can. And so a lot of times the kids didn't have printers or computers at home. So I allowed them to use my printer and my computer. Never charged them anything. Never wow. asked the parents to do anything. Except the policy is when we have a meeting, you can come in. So we had different activities. We did notebooks, made journals. And I let them decorate it. So it was just different activities that I was trying to show them something positive
right.
that they could be doing and something positive in the community. And so at the end of me moving, those parents came to me and they were very appreciative because some of those kids that I didn't know their home life and what they were struggling with, really was struggling with, because some of the parents were on drugs, some were in rehab, some were a single parent coming from single parent families. But that was the back end because I didn't know their story. But I was glad that I could help make a difference. And what I do, I still try to stay in contact with those young ladies to make sure that they're still on the right road, still doing, you know, the things that positive, they're reaching their dreams. And so that's how Girls Help Girls got started.
Oh, my God. You are. I'm, like, getting all emotional listening to you. You're such an amazing woman. Because, and you really are. You're such an amazing woman. And I am truly humbled to, I feel like you're doing me a favor. Just sitting, you know what I mean? Like, I'm so honored to be in your presence.
Know, I'm honored to be with you.
I really am, because I'm, for you to see three girls mm-hmm. that, and I want to point this out so that those of you listening can understand. The three girls on her page are not her ethnicity. They weren't little African-American Mm-mm. girls. And for you to see these young girls and just the concern as a parent, mm-hmm. as a human being, that, wow, they're hanging out with older boys right. and they're really young. And, you know, and some of us may have gone, ooh, that's not a good thing to do.
Right, right.
Some of may even take a step further and pray like, oh, God, you know.
Right.
Please. You actually did something about
right.
it.
Right.
And opened your home, mm-hmm. and for the sake of those three girls, created a community club.
Right.
Invited the parents in, mm-hmm. and then it just went from there.
Right.
I think that's so amazing.
Because going back to my raising,
right,
did not see color. I saw three girls standing outside. That's all I saw. Right. It did not matter what color they were. It was just, I saw those three girls, and I could see the road in which they were about to travel down. And I'm saying, now, am I just going to stand here on this porch and not say anything? Mm-hmm. Or am I just going to go down and introduce myself to them and say, you know, what's your name? What grade you in? You know, that type thing. So before I knew it, I was before them, and I was asking these questions. Because I could not stand on that porch and watch these girls go down a road that was not the road that they did not want to go down.
Wow. That is so incredible. That is, and so, and the fact that you still keep in touch with
yes,
them.
Yes.
After all this time.
Yes.
And by you opening that door, you actually found out what was going on in some of their homes.
Right.
As to why they were unsupervised.
Right. Yes, and it was just surprising. Like I say, when I got ready to leave, the parents came, and they was like, you know, we thankful for what you've done for our girls, but we hate that you are leaving the community, you know, because what you don't know is that one of the parents was already in rehab.
Oh, my God.
And some of the kids, one of the girls came from a single parent.
Right.
I did have some girls that came from two-parent households, but to know that, I had been able to change, because one of the parents said that their daughter was very shy. She would not speak. And when she came mm-hmm. to me, she was very shy. She wouldn't talk much. I would have to just keep asking her questions, keep asking, you know, okay, would you like to, you know, design your journal? Would you like to be the secretary? See, what I did was, not only did I bring these girls into my home, mm-hmm. I gave them responsibilities.
Wow.
So, okay, we're going to vote on who wants to be president. Mm-hmm. Who wants to be the secretary? Who wants to be the treasurer? If we had money that somebody donated something, you got to keep a log of what we have. So I allowed them to have the responsibility so that they now, when they go out, they know about responsibilities. They know about giving somebody a task to do. So they also, you know, they learned that too. So I wanted them to be able to be those women that they could stand up for themselves and to have that knowledge and to receive the, you know, what I learned is, it's what it really is about, is what I learned from my grandparents mm-hmm. that I can give to somebody else.
I just, I think the thing that's so amazing to me is where these girls would be had you not.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Had you not stepped up.
Right.
And be a hero for them.
Right.
Where their lives would end up.
Right.
And, you know, that they could be the statistic.
Right, right.
That,
right.
You know, we could sit back and point the finger at.
Right,
or,
right, right.
You know what I mean? That you, God used you as a defense
right.
and as a block mm-hmm. against where life wanted to take them.
Right.
You know, where the enemy wanted to take them.
Right, right.
And
and gave you favor with the parents mm-hmm. and with the community. Mm-hmm. And just in the way that you didn't see color.
Right.
The parents didn't see color
right.
in you.
Right.
And it was just like, okay, we're going to start a community right. club and we're going to do this.
We're going to do this. We're going to do it together.
So how are those girls today?
Those girls are good. They are in high school. Mm-hmm. They're doing good. Mm-hmm. I haven't talked to them in probably a couple of months. Mm-hmm. But the last time we talked, we communicate on Facebook. So, uh-huh. we, you know, make sure. They're doing good. I have one of the girls. She's in college.
Wow.
I think she's the first in her family to go to college.
Wow.
But she's getting her college degree. And so that was the thing, making sure that they don't allow, like I said, let somebody put you in that box because of what is going on behind your four walls in your house. Don't right. allow that noise, that breakdown, that trouble stop you from achieving what you so desire in life.
Oh, my God. I love it. For those of you who are listening, I really hope that you're touched by Ms. Carlton and this organization. This is the nucleus of Girls Helping Girls. And if what you have heard has touched you in any way, shape, or form, when we come back, we're going to talk about some of the ways that you can assist her. We're going to find out where she is in the program. If you're listening and you're looking for something that you want to put your hand to, you have a gift or a talent that you would like to lend to this organization, we're going to talk about that when we come back. We'll be back in just a moment.
Do you have any questions, comments, or concerns about today's show? Would you like to share your testimony or any constructive critiques? Would you like to know how to be a guest on The Simone Edwards Show? Please feel free to email us at thesimoneedwardsshow@gmail.com. We are also available on Facebook, Pinterest, and Instagram. Be sure to follow us to receive updates regarding the show and our other ministries.
All right, we are back here in studio with Ms. Tiwana Carlton of Girls Helping Girls, and I'm stunned because we are 13 minutes away from the top of the hour, so we're almost done. So let's talk about where are you in this? Where are you as far as the organizational structure of the nonprofit? What do you have? What are you lacking?
Okay. I do the day-to-day. And like I said, I have a board.
Okay.
So I have to consult with my board, you know, yeah. everything. They have to make the decision. But as far as the day-to-day operations, going out into the community, letting the community know mm-hmm. these are the services we offer, I do that myself. You know, I try to make sure I participate in connections and, you know, when they have like they had the San Diego Professional Black meetup and greet. Mm-hmm. Just going out meeting other people and letting them know that I'm here in the community and these are the programs that we offer to girls ages 10 to 17. So that's okay. what I do. Mm-hmm.
So as far as, you know, your social media presence and you know, you're already doing the grassroots advertising.
Right.
You really don't have anyone helping you with that.
No, I get up, I plan it. Mm. I do all my social media. I do all the, you know, sometimes people say they have people that write for their social media. No, I do it all myself. I get the inspiration. I get up and I pray and I ask God to lead me and guide me in what I need to say and what I need to do. And so that's, I get up and I do all my social, I interact, you know, people hit me in my inbox. They want to know more about it, mm-hmm. about Girls Help Girls. And I make sure that I myself respond to those emails. I don't allow someone else to do it because I want to have that personal relationship. Mm-hmm. And so as far as the branding and the social media, I try to connect with other women that have been in the business mm-hmm. as far as branding, doing social media, and how to get your business out there. So I try to stay connected with those women on social media. Right now I'm in a mentoring program. And this is my first time, like I say, stepping outside that box mm-hmm. because we have to learn to invest in ourselves. How can I bring to these girls these programs and show them and guide them if I don't have what I need?
That's what I was thinking. Yes. I love that because you who are starting a mentoring program, mm-hmm. you're already a part of a mentoring program.
Yes, because I had to learn that I had to put myself first. And mm-hmm. in order for me to be first, in order for me to be able to spread my wings and bring these girls along and to show them, then I have to be an example. Because if I'm up here, you know, giving them a program and trying to talk to them and showing them examples, and they're looking at me saying, well, what are you doing?
Right.
What are you doing? You don't have a degree. You don't have the training. But you're going to tell me, you know, this is what I need to achieve. But have you achieved your goals?
Right.
You know, so I have to be an example. So therefore, I got to go out and I have to make sure that I receive the training. Mm-hmm. I have to make sure I have a mentor. Right now, my first time, I have an accountability partner. Mm-hmm. So I have to be accountable. For if I say I'm going to do it, my partner is going to call me out. Okay, well, you said you were going to do this, this, and this. And so that's why, you know, you have to have the training. Because if I'm going to be the example for these young girls, mm-hmm. I got to step my game up.
I am so impressed by you. I really am. I'm just so impressed by who you are as a person. So, hey, listen, we're making a plea here on the Simone Edwards Show. If you are in the San Diego area and you have been looking for a not-for-profit organization that you would like to volunteer with, yes. Offer your services. Your strength is in administration, and you can get things organized and you can get stuff going. Definitely connect with Miss Tiwana Carlton. You know, if you want to help her out with her Facebook post, she'll give you the information. You just put it up there for her. Those of you out there that are graphic artists, that, you know, you can come in, take her idea and take it to the next level.
Yes.
Reach out to this woman and contact her. She's an amazing woman. I've met her today and I'm truly impressed with her and with her heart for the community and her love for children. And she's really trying to do an amazing work. So you can reach out to her through the Simone Edwards Show, or you can contact, how can they contact you?
They can contact me. We are on all social media mm-hmm. platforms at Girls Help Girls, One Hand at a Time. And you can also reach out to us through our email. It's girls, all small letters, girlshelpgirls1@gmail.com.
Okay, and so that's girlshelpgirl1@gmail.com. We are headed down towards, we're about 8 minutes away from the top of the show. You recently, what do you do to keep yourself, as a CEO of Girl Help Girls, what do you do to keep yourself motivated? And what do you do to challenge yourself so that you continually embody the mission statement of the organization?
To keep myself motivated, I try to, like I said, I have a mentor. Mm-hmm. And so receiving that, that's something I've never done. Mm-hmm. Because what I do is, like I said, I got it from my grandparents. So I just brought that along, mm-hmm. that teaching, that learning. And so that keeps me motivated, knowing that what I know and what my grandparents taught me, mm-hmm. that I can pass that on to another young girl and she can be able to achieve her goals, her needs, her wants. And so I just want to be, that keeps me motivated, knowing that one day that I can see the results of what I've poured into these young girls, you know, and letting them know that, like I said, don't allow someone to put you in that box.
Right.
And so, you know, just being, having a mentor, mm-hmm. having an accountability partner, that keeps me motivated, because I got to keep my game up, mm-hmm. because I got to realize, even though I may not have a young girl that's in my program, but she may be standing outside watching, seeing right. those other girls that's in the program, saying, okay, so that's what she's doing with them. And so I got to be mindful of that. I be mindful of what I say on my social media. I be mindful of what I do in the community or when I'm out or even in my house. So I got to be mindful, because I don't know what young girl could be standing on the other side of my door and listening to what I may be saying, what I may be doing, and saying that she sees me, she sees me when I walk out, but she doesn't know, you know, what's going on behind my doors. But I got to be mindful that those girls are paying attention
right.
to everything you say, everything you do, the way you look, and all that. So I have to, that keeps me motivated that, okay, somebody's watching you, mm-hmm. and you don't never know who's watching. And so you got to stay motivated and stay up on your game.
I love it.
Yes.
So now, some of the programs that you started, when you started with your girls uh-huh. in
Oxnard.
You trans those programs still continue over into your program, your current program today.
Right.
So talk to us about some of the programming that's available. Your day camps. Give us a little spiel about
what we offer is a 1 or 2 day camp. Uh-huh. And it's what I realize is that a lot of times it's hard for parents and people to come to you. Mm-hmm. So what I've decided is, and I didn't decide, God said, okay, instead of you saying, come to me, you take your camp to them.
Oh, I love it.
So if you have a community club, a mentoring club, or you mentor girls, young girls in your home or in the community, we can bring it to you. We bring our camp. And what we offer is, I'm in the process now of revamping our programs. Mm-hmm. And some of the programs that we do is My Vision. And so what I did was try to change the wording up, because you know you got to check, kind of catch these the kids now. They got to get with the slang, and so I got to stay up on my game. And so instead of saying we're gonna talk about it, we're gonna do a vision board. It's my dream. Mm-hmm. This is your dream. Mm-hmm. And so what I've done, and I've worked with some women also about their vision boards. And so what I tell them is, you put your picture on that vision board, mm-hmm. because this is your vision. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to go from there. And so that's one of the things. Another thing that we do is That's Me. Mm-hmm. That talks about a mirror image. Mm-hmm. What we don't realize is what we see in that mirror, mm-hmm. is what other people see. Mm-hmm. And so we also do, AT&T has a new thing, Don't Text and Drive. Mm-hmm. And so, like I said, I wanted to stay hip with the kids. So instead of us sitting behind a simulator, how about hula hoops? Mm-hmm. Now let's take that hula hoop and your phone, mm-hmm. and let's go through an obstacle, and let's see how many texts you can do without making this obstacle fall down. So I tried to make the programs fun. Another one is Be Your Own Boss Chick. Mm-hmm. And what we do is that we have something called Walk Like Naomi Campbell. Mm-hmm. And so that means that you're going to have to walk the runway. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to design an outfit, mm-hmm. as a group. And so therefore, the girls have to learn to communicate. So that's what I meant by going back to basics.
Right.
So we're putting that phone down. We're putting those computers down. Now you got to communicate with complete strangers, mm-hmm. that you don't even know. Mm-hmm. And we got to figure out how we're going to make an outfit. And we got to put it together. And we, mm-hmm. got to walk down this runway like Naomi Campbell.
I absolutely love that.
Yes.
And so, and one of the things I think that's really innovative about your not-for-profit is the fact that you'll come to them. And so if it's kind of like, if you can get the girls together,
right.
you can contact Miss Tiwana, and she will bring her program to you, to your center, to where you're located, and it'll take place there.
Right.
And then you don't have to worry about transportation or how do I get, you know, these 10, 15 girls,
right.
across town. She'll package all her stuff together and she'll come to you. Mm-hmm. We're about 2 minutes away from the top of the hour, so I just wanted to again just put a plea out there for this organization, that if you are looking for, we're in the second month of the brand new year, and I know someone out there made a resolution or made a determination that they were going to get involved in the community this year. Well, this is your opportunity. The opportunity you are looking for is right here with Miss Carlton of Girls Help Girls, one hand at a time. She's making a difference. This is a woman who lives what she preaches.
Yes.
Started back in Port Hueneme. I will never forget that story ever. Started in Port Hueneme, and it's now here in San Diego. I would say it was birthed in Port Hueneme.
Yes, yes.
And you know, the genesis, it started there.
Right.
And the child has come to, is now here in the world. The manifestation of it.
Yes.
Is here in San Diego. And so if you would like to connect with her, please reach out to her. You can do that through the Simone Edwards Show at gmail.com, or you can contact her at
Girls Help Girls, one hand at a time on all social media platforms. And then our email is girlshelpgirls1@gmail.com.
And you can definitely check out our Facebook page. We have liked her page on our Facebook page, so you can get to her that way. Again, you can email us at the Simone Edwards Show show, we'll get that information to her. Or you can email her yourself at girlshelpgirls1, the number one, at gmail.com. You can look for them on all social media platforms at Girls Help Girls, one hand at a time. Thank you so much for tuning in. We will see you next time here on the Simone Edwards Show. Enjoy the rest of your Saturday and do what Miss Carlton did. Put your money where your mouth is and make a difference in the life of someone. We'll see you next time. Bye.